G'day, Chris here, and welcome back to Clickspring. So after much work on the structure and gearing of the mechanism, we can now have a look at what it was all designed to do. And starting with the backplate, the remains of the device have proven to be just enough for various researchers to piece together the likely markings, revealing much about both the machine itself and the world in which it was constructed. This includes, as a major feature, what is probably the most complete calendar from the ancient Greek world, a lunar-solar calendar based upon the 19-year Metonic cycle, with the 235 lunar months laid out around a five-turn spiral. There are also two subsidiary dials, one observable in the wreckage and the other assumed, as well as some more subtle markings that permit correct interpretation of the dial. The dial was designed to give the user a lot of information all at once, and some of it is quite unfamiliar from our modern perspective. The commonly used Gregorian calendar, for example, has a very different structure, so this presentation isn't immediately recognisable to most of us, and so requires a little decoding. So let's start with the building blocks of the calendar, those small cells that represent the lunar months. The ancient Greeks made sure that their months would ideally follow the phases of the moon. The first of the month was the day after new moon, when, theoretically, a small sliver would first be visible at sunset. The 15th was around the middle of the month at full moon. And the end of the month was defined as when the moon was no longer visible, or new moon. Each of these cycles was defined as a month, and naturally enough, given a name. And while we're on the subject of names, there was a fair amount of regional variation in the month names. But there was also some interesting overlap and commonality, to the extent that month names tend to be a useful tool in determining the regional origin of a given calendar. And as we'll go through later, the presence of a specific set of month names on the mechanism has been used to do just that. In any event, 12 lunar months in series was the most basic representation of any given local calendar. As appropriate to the region, the 12 months were cycled through in accordance with a system of regulation that served to synchronise what was in practice a lunar cycle-based calendar with the local seasons. Now, that system of regulation happens to be a critical aspect of how the whole thing worked, because as convenient as it is to have a calendar based upon months that anybody can simply look at the sky to verify, a series of 12 lunar cycles, as measured in days, falls well short of a solar year. And of course, the length of a lunar month is also not a neat integer number of days. Without some sort of remedy, before long the months would drift noticeably from the seasons, and the lunar phase would drift out of alignment with the months. A solution well known in the ancient world was to use a set of rules to specify when there should be an additional or intercalary 13th month to maintain seasonal alignment, and when a given month was to be of either 29 or 30 day duration. And in our case, that system is the Metonic calendar. It's a calendar based around the fortunate coincidence I mentioned in a previous video, where 235 lunar months almost exactly equals 19 solar years. This permits a close enough whole number reconciliation between the solar and lunar cycles over those periods, hence the name Lunar Solar Calendar. The 235 months were laid out in a radial pattern of 5 spirals, each of 47 cells, with the dial divisions running radially, directly across each of the spiral turns. The display was intended to run clockwise out from the centre. Years were presented in sequence from 1 to 19 around the spiral. Seven of the years were intercalary years, and so 13 months in duration. And it's believed that these intercalary years were spread out relatively evenly across the sequence of 19. All months were nominally presented as being 30 days in duration, or what's known as full. However, 110 months were prescribed to drop a day to be 29 days in duration, and so become hollow. 110 being neatly divisible by 5 means that on a 5 spiral dial, these hollow months can be conveniently displayed as 22 regularly spaced groups of 5, sharing the same radial sector. and the evidence suggests that the index numbers associated with each radial sector specified which day of each of those months was to be skipped. So, for example, each month on this sector is hollow, so of 29 days duration, and skipped day 23. This clever use of the neat divisibility of both 110 and 235 by 5 is the reason behind the 5 spiral layout of this dial. It was an intentional choice of the maker to make use of what amounts to 5 subcycles of 47 to simplify the presentation of the full sequence of 235 months. This choice permitted a compact and predictable display of the Metonic cycle and also ensured just enough space for each cell to contain a legible text engraving of each month name. And speaking of month names, let's go through them now, as I mark out the dial in preparation for engraving. All of the text on the device is of course inscribed in ancient Greek, which means the text is in all capitals. There are no spaces, accents, or punctuation. And often ancient Greek tends to be written as blocks of text. But in the case of the month names on this mechanism, they're divided mostly by syllable over 2 or 3 lines, with the smallest characters just a little over 1 millimetre tall. Okay, so the month names in sequence are Phinikaios, Kranios, Lanatropios, Makanefs, the month now understood to be the intercalary month, Dodecatevs, Efklios, Artemisios, Psidrefs, Gamelios, Agrianios, Panamos, and finally, Apuleios. Now, disputes regarding pronunciation aside, if you've followed along reading these names out loud for yourself, then congratulations, because you've just given voice to the month names of a very old calendar, the complete list and month order of which only became known with the rediscovery of the mechanism. The calendar is understood to be of Corinthian origin, and most likely from the ancient region of Epirus, an area now shared between northwestern Greece and southern Albania. And its existence on the mechanism suggests an association between the device and this region. Now, the main calendar was intended to be interpreted in context with its subsidiary dials, the Games dial and the assumed Callippic dial. Each of these dials was divided into 4 sectors, with each quadrant of the Callippic dial indicating progress of the Callippic cycle, and each quadrant in the Games dial indicating the sequence of the Pan-Hellenic Games, with this dial in particular set a few degrees anti-clockwise relative to the natural axis of the plate. The text of the Games dial may provide an indication of where the device was constructed. Derek de Sola Price first put forward the idea that the mechanism may have been associated with the device-making tradition of Rhodes. And more recently, the reading of the relatively low-significance Harleian Games of Rhodes on this dial has been interpreted as possibly supporting that suggestion. Okay, so that's the top half of the plate marked out. Time to make a start on the engraving. The remains of the mechanism suggest a Burin-style cutting tool with a V-shaped cutting face. In the modern context, the cutting edge of an engraving tool is usually modified to include a small heel to reduce the tendency for the tool to dig in. And that heel is sized according to the preference of each engraver. But one thing common to all engraving cutters is that they must be quite hard and able to retain a very sharp edge to be capable of doing an acceptable job. So again, we have a reason to investigate what sort of material was used for this cutting tool to make the cleanly inscribed cuts that we can see in the remains of the mechanism. The tempered martensite that I've shown in use in previous episodes is again an excellent candidate to consider. For those that haven't yet seen those videos, it's a carburised iron that could have been quite easily produced on demand in the ancient workshop using commonly available materials. It can be quenched in water to a glass-hard, martensitic state, but in its annealed state, it can be fairly easily worked into just about any required shape using files or abrasive stones. In this case, I've formed a roughly 90 degree V-shaped cutting edge with a slight taper towards the cutting face. The The material is then taken to a red heat and quenched again to transform it back into martensite. The material is then tempered back slightly and finally sharpened on a brace of stones. The metal is still very hard, but importantly, also now tough enough to accept a sharp edge, and able to retain that edge and the heel facets throughout the cutting process, ensuring a consistent and repeatable engraving standard across the workpiece. Now my preference is to use a hammer to drive the cutter, but it could just as easily have been used as a push engraver, depending on the maker's preference. The objective in each case being maintaining careful control of the cut. The tool preparation may have had a few extra steps, but from here, the workflow is much the same as for a modern engraver. Importantly, the tool handles as expected, and the cutter forms bright chips, generating the clean-edged cuts that can be seen in the remains of the mechanism. The text that can be viewed on the original mechanism provides some guidance to follow for the ancient Greek lettering style. And there's some interesting detail on the characters to be found in the scans. Much of the lettering is serifed, which gives it quite a formal appearance. Pi is the first character to catch the eye with its unequal legs, the second a little shorter than the first and with a slight curl or a more pronounced serif. Sigma also has an interesting appearance, not always but often with its top and bottom lines a little splayed as opposed to horizontal. And Mu often has a similar kind of splay with the two outside lines at an angle rather than vertical. Ypsilon often has a short vertical stroke. Phi has a slightly flattened appearance. And Omicron is well represented as the little O, often raised relative to the other text. Now the significance of all of this is open for interpretation. Much of it could simply be a result of tiny engraved characters being forced into a small space. but there's been quite a bit of discussion on it all, so be sure to check out the research linked in the description for more detail. In any event, the engraving work itself is a time-consuming task, making this component easily the most labour-intensive of the build so far. So as we approach the completion of this section of the plate, it's worth pointing out that numbers on the mechanism are indicated using the Greek letters for numbers system, where, for example, the alpha character represents 1, beta 2, gamma 3, and so on. A good example to see this in use is the game's dial. When combined with the L-shaped symbol for year, the letters alpha, beta, gamma, and delta represent the first, second, third, and fourth years of the game's cycle. And we also see this system used for the skipped days of the hollow months, the months on the radial sector corresponding with alpha skip day 1, with epsilon day 5, with theta day 9. For higher numbers, the numbering system is additive. So, for example, iota gamma represents 10 plus 3, or 13, iota theta 19, kappa gamma 23, and so on. And so the mechanism provided the user with a comprehensive layout of the excluded days of each month for the entire 235-month cycle. Now I'll go through how the games and calypic dials are read in conjunction with this Metonic calendar and the rest of the backplate in the next video. But for now, let's put all of this together and have a go at reading just the calendar. For example, this stretch of 12 cells represents a single 12-month year. The first cell of the year, as always, is the month Phoenicaos. And we see the L-shaped year symbol followed by an epsilon, so we know that this year is year 5. As an example, the 7th month of this year, Artemisios, has no characters inscribed on the inside of its radius segment. So we know that in this year, Artemisios is a full month with 30 days. However, the very next month along, Sidrefs, does have a number on the inside of its radius. So we know that it's a hollow month of 29 days. The characters kappa alpha indicate the number 21. So we know that there's no 21st day for the month of Sidrefs in the 5th year of the Metonic cycle. Now that was a year of 12 lunar months duration. Let's try another one, this time an intercalary year. This year is 13 lunar months in duration, and a closer look at that first cell tells us that it's year 9. As an intercalary year, it has an additional intercalary month of Mukhanefs, immediately following the standard month of Mukhanefs. And with no number on the inside of its radius segment, we can confirm that this additional month is a full 30 days in length. However, the preceding month does have a number on the inside radius, so we know that it's hollow, and that there's no 17th day for this month of Mukhanefs in the 9th year of the Metonic cycle. Now all of this takes quite a bit to get used to, so be assured, we'll go through it all again in part 2 of this video, when I cover the inscriptions for the Saros dial. But with this section of the dial reconstructed, another small test is complete, that shows, like so many of the other cut features, a simple tempered martensite cutting tool is quite capable of producing the fine, crisply engraved detail that can be observed in the wreckage of the Antikythera mechanism. Thanks for watching. I'll see you later.